Thank you, and good morning. Isn't that a beautiful sound in the dawn? Well, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Dean Thomas. I'm the CEO at Canterbury Helston Park RSL. And on behalf of all of us here at the club and the sub-ranch, we thank you for coming out on this morning. I suppose we shouldn't be surprised, given the events of this year, this morning's weather. So we will, as they say, we will march on. In a few moments' time, the service will begin. As you know, on Anzac Day, traditions are very, very important. It's also important, however, that those traditions evolve. So last year, we began a new tradition, which was that the young people from our community would lead us in our dawn service. So, as like last year, the students from Canterbury Girls High School and Canterbury Public School will be taking you through your service in a few moments' time. Just a reminder that you are all welcome for breakfast inside the club. I'm sure you'll have earned it today following the service. The breakfast is complimentary, however, we do ask for a donation to the charities, the veterans charities that we are supporting this year. So there are three groups we are supporting. RSL Life Care, we're helping them in their efforts to establish a veteran wellbeing centre in the city. Swiss 8, which is a veteran charity that assists veterans with their mental wellness. And Disaster Relief Australia, which is another veteran organisation who employ ex-Defence Force personnel. And those personnel are then deployed in areas which have suffered from a disaster. So it will come as no surprise to you that Disaster Relief Australia are taking a leading role in the Northern Rivers at the moment. So by joining us for breakfast, you will be showing your support to those very worthwhile organisations. And once again, on behalf of all of us here at Canterbury Helston Park RSL, we thank you for your attendance. Our service will begin now.
Good morning, and welcome to the Canterbury Helston Park RSL Anzac Day Dawn Service. My name is Annabelle, and I am one of the co-captains at Canterbury Girls High School. And this is Emily, who is a member of the PFF body. We will be emceeing today's dawn service. Today marks 107 years since Australian and New Zealand forces landed at Gallipoli, where they were willing to make the ultimate sacrifice in order to protect their country. To me, Anzac Day is a day to remember the fallen, to pay respect to our ex-service men and women, and to honour those who continue to serve today. Here, we commemorate the legacy that those before us have left behind and that those today continue to contribute to. This service is broadcasted live on Facebook Watch. You may record images, but please do so in a respectful manner. And please ensure that your phone is on silent. I'd like to welcome Uncle Brendan to the stage for the Welcome to Country.
Good morning, everyone. My name's Brendan. I'm a cultural representative from Metropolitan Aboriginal Land Council in Sydney, and our role as Aboriginal Land Council under the Land Rights Act, we have become the guardians and custodians of land, water and air within the boundaries of the Eora Nation. The boundaries of the Eora Nation start from the ocean, and they're surrounded by what I always say, three of the world's most beautiful rivers. You've got the Hawkesbury River, the Nepean River, and the Georges River. And in between those three mighty and beautiful rivers, we've got 29 clans which make up the Eora Nation. And the name of the clan that we're gathered on here today is Wongal. So on behalf of myself, on behalf of Metropolitan Aboriginal Land Council, I'd like to welcome everyone here this morning to Wongal Land. It's always an honour and a privilege for me as an Aboriginal person to perform Welcome to Country. 10 years ago, I would never have had the option to perform a Welcome to Country or an acknowledgement of country. So for me, it shows as a nation we're moving forward in the way of recognition and acknowledgement of Aboriginal people. And I know for a fact 10 years ago you would never have had a Welcome to Country performed by such a good-looking bloke as myself, especially at this time of the morning. Very briefly, my connection to country, I was born at Surry Hills, and from Surry Hills, Crown Street Women's Hospital, and that's the last time that I ever felt my mother's touch in that hospital. So in my journey of identity and connection to country, once that removal took place, I was removed from country, language, culture, tradition and family. So I was more or less forced to adopt Sydney as home. For a long time, I again didn't have a traditional home. And it's one of the two questions as Aboriginal people we ask each other is, who's your mob and where do you come from? And as I said, for a long time, I couldn't answer that question. I can stand here now and proudly say I'm a Murrawarra man from Lake Victoria, which is right down in the corner of New South Victoria and South Australian borders. You know, Murrawarra, where Southern Barkindji, Barker meaning Darling River, Barkindji, Darling River people. I've had a lot of fun when it comes to identity and culture, and I'll give a few quick examples. I lived in Newtown for a while as a young fellow, and I remember the old Greeks as a great community in Newtown. I remember the old Greeks swinging their prayer beads and come up and start talking to me in their language. And I just say, oh, I've got no idea what you're talking about. And they'd say, oh, we're sorry, you look like you come from Cyprus. And then I moved to Murrayfield, a Murrayfield Maltese community. And the same thing happened to me over there. Oh, you look like you sure you're not related to the Phoenix? And one day I had a light bulb moment, and I thought if I was to grow a long beard and buy a gold cross and I was to go and rob a bank, the description of the bank robber would be Middle Eastern European. And I could run around home, have a shave and get away with it. And I'll be honest here, I never robbed that bank. I did think about it for a little while. So that's my connection to country, and I think it's brilliant initiative here of getting the young and the next generation involved. I've got four little ones at home under the age of 7, and they're marching today. And my 5-year-old daughter said to me, I said, you're going to march tonight? She said, yeah, I will. I'm going up to help the old people walk. I said, well, that's great. My son, my 7-year-old boy, I said, you're going to march tomorrow? Oh, only if my mates are going. And I thought, that's that sort of culture I grew up with, is your mates and respect and helping your elders and having that next generation involved. So once again, welcome to Wongal Land. It's always an honour and a privilege, and thank you for having me here.
Thank you, Uncle Brendan. We would like to invite Mr. Malcolm Little, OAM Vice President of the Huston Park RSL sub-branch, to say a few words.
Good morning, and I'm Malcolm Little. I'm acting president of Canterbury Hurlston Park RSL sub-branch. We, on behalf of the committee and the members of Canterbury Hurlston Park sub-branch, I welcome you here this morning. Today is Anzac Day, 25th of April. While Anzac Day commemorates the landing of the Australian and New Zealand Army Corps on Gallipoli in 1915. It's also the date on which we remember all Australian war dead and those who served. Apart from World War I from 1914 to 1918 and World War II from 1939 to 1945. Did you also know Australian sporting Korea from 1950 to 1953 and Malaya from 1948 to 1960 and Borneo from 1962 to 1966 and Vietnam from 1962 to 1972, and Iraq and Afghanistan? Or that Australians have served in over 35 peacekeeping missions since the end of World War II. In World War I, Australians had almost 62,000 killed and more than twice that number wounded. And within 14 years of the end of World War I, an additional 38,000 returned Australian servicemen had died. Died because of wounds received, shattered health, and suicide. We're hearing a lot about PTSD and veteran suicide these days, but it's been an issue for veterans following wars for hundreds, if not thousands of years. How do wars start in the first place? Who starts them? Well, with World War I, Austria ordered to put troops into Serbia. And Serbia said no, but Austria did so anyway. Then Russia, who was a mate of Serbia's, declared war on Austria. Germany was a mate of Austria's, so it declared war on Russia. France was a mate of Russia's, so it declared war on Germany. And Austria. And because Great Britain was a mate of France, it too declared war on Austria and Germany. And because we were mates with the Brits, we joined in too. Then Turkey, which was always a bit worried about the Russians, joined in on the side of the Germans and Austrians. And the results: 16 million dead, 20 million wounded, 8 million permanently disabled, homes and lives shattered. And 20 years after the end of World War I, it all started again when Germany invaded Poland on the 1st of September 1939. That war, World War II, ran for 6 years and cost more lives than any war in history, with a death toll of between 70 and 85 million. I've spoken about wars, how wars start. Now I'll talk about why. It always starts with a bully, someone picking on another person, country that's weaker. In Christianity and Judaism, there's a set of what we call the Ten Commandments. It's a set of rules about how God wants us to live. The last of these commandments deals with wanting something that belongs to someone else. It's called coveting. Wanting something that doesn't belong to you. And the breaking of this rule has been the cause of more wars, more deaths, more misery, more sorrow, more destruction than anything else. In World War I, Austria wanted Serbia, Germany wanted France and Belgium. In World War II, Germany wanted Europe, and Japan wanted Asia. And in the Korean War, the Communist North wanted the non-communist South, and it was the same story in Vietnam. These days, it's Russia plotting Ukraine. See the pattern? It's the big picking on the small, the strong picking on the weak. So what today we remember those who fought, those who were wounded, those who died on our behalf, and who did so because they were prepared to stand up to the bully. Let's hope and pray that we shall not someday have to do it all over again. Best we forget.
For those who can, please stand for the mounting of the Kakatau Party.
Excuse me. Sorry.
Reverend Steve Gardner of the St. Paul Church here in Canterbury will now lead us into the ceremony of remembrance.
Good morning. And good on you for braving the weather today. I'll be leading us in some prayers for peace, fittingly following on from Malcolm's word, particularly in light of the conflict in Europe at the moment, and prayers for those who continue to serve in the defence forces. But I want to begin by reading those famous words of Lawrence Binyon, you'll know, words that have been immortalised in the ode, "They shall not grow old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun in the morning, we will remember them." The words that have captured our imagination and for generations, an imagination of a national identity. And today, this Anzac Day gives us a pause and a moment of substance and meaning to reflect on those words. The next stanza of that poem reminds us, and a stanza that's often forgotten, reminds us of the cost of war, the cost of that first Anzac Day. It goes on like this: "They mingle not with their laughing comrades again. They sit no more at familiar tables at home." So today's a gift to us, a day of genuine substance and meaning to ponder again the costs of war. And we remember that first Anzac Day, the almost instant slaughter of nearly 11,000 Australians and New Zealanders that have left scars on our families and our national consciences, scars that remain for generations actually, and since then, new scars have formed in ongoing conflicts, as Malcolm's remind us, be that in World War II, or Korea, or Vietnam, or Iraq, or Afghanistan. And we remember today that those scars are not in vain. And Anzac Day causes us not to glorify war, but to remember the cost of it, and to acknowledge the very real, heartfelt longings each of us has for lasting freedom and justice and peace. So we naturally groan at the events we're seeing play out in Europe as one nation invades another, because we know deep down this is not the way it ought to be. There's a verse in the Bible that paints a picture of the genuine and lasting freedom, justice and peace that God will bring. From an ancient book in Isaiah, it says, God will judge between the nations and will settle disputes for many peoples. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. Might be a bit too hard to believe a day like that, where instruments of destruction turned into instruments of farming and flourishing. But it's a day that the scriptures say God has purchased in his very own costly way, in the shedding of the blood of his son, Jesus Christ, who entered into the darkness and chaos of the world at war to show us a glimpse of what real freedom and justice and peace could look like. But above all, he gave himself up to the hostility and horrors that the world would throw at him, as he felt the full force of it in his death on the cross, one of the cruelest instruments of war that's ever been created. And we wait for a day of genuine freedom, lasting freedom, justice and peace that he will bring, when nations will drop their swords. And while we wait for that day, we still will feel those scars. We'll still feel the cost of war. And so in the midst of that, the story of Jesus offers us substance and meaning in a way that helps define us and gives us hope that even in the valley of the shadow of death, a psalm many of our troops have held dear, he's with us. Even in the trenches of Gallipoli, in the heartbreaking loss of loved ones who've never returned home, and in the pit of grief, he is with us, no matter what shadow we face. I'd like to lead us in prayer for peace. Great God, loving Heavenly Father, you've found us together in a common life. So help us in the midst of our struggles for justice and truth to confront one another without hatred or bitterness, to work together through mutual forbearance and respect. We pray that you'll banish from the hearts of all the spirit that wages war and bring peace to the nations, we pray. I'd like to pray for our servicemen and women. Almighty God, we commend to your gracious care and keeping all the men and women of our armed forces at home and abroad. Defend them day by day with your heavenly grace. Strengthen them in their trials and temptations. Give them courage to face the perils which beset them, and grant them a sense of abiding, your abiding presence wherever they may be. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen. We're now going to have a famous hymn, Abide By Me, played. The words are in your order of service. You might like to take them out and read them or sing them out as we reflect on this together. Thank you.
Thank you, Reverend Gardner and your choir. I'd now like to introduce Rose Bernard, followed by Junichi Young from Canterbury Public School, to say a few words about what Anzac Day means to them. What does Anzac Day mean to us? Anzac Day is a national day that broadly commemorates Australia and New Zealanders who fought in the war with our many allies. Every individual Anzac risks their lives just so we can live freely right here in Australia and New Zealand. A lot of Australians have a connection to someone who served in the Anzacs. In my family, I have my great uncle. He served as an airman, slowing the advance of the Nazis in France. That's when his plane got shot down, but he was saved by a lady, also known for saving other airmen in France in this situation. By the Nazis, she was known as the White Nurse. Her real name was Nancy Wake. Upon returning to Australia, Uncle Eric raised a family in the Northern Beaches. When Nancy moved to Australia, they would often share stories with each other. Although a traumatic experience, they all knew they were lucky to be alive. Over many decades, the Anzac Alliance has remained strong. In our hearts and days, like today, help us to remember how important the Anzac tradition is.
To me, the people that fought in the war didn't fight for war, they fought for the benefit of the world and the benefits of their country. They sacrificed a great deal and many thousands lost their lives. My great-grandpa Blair was called up in 1939 when he just turned 18 and served in the British Army in Greece and Israel. I know that he experienced a lot of trauma and sadness, and even though he didn't talk about it much at all, you should say that he lost the best years of his life. My great-grandpa, Kerwin, was sent to Papua New Guinea, and during the battle, he was wounded in the back and hip. Despite his injuries, he dragged his offer to safety. For that, he won a military medal for bravery. But great-grandpa, Kerwin, was scared by the war and was never known the same after. Anzac Day to me is about saying thank you to all the Australians who sacrificed their lives and futures to ensure that we as Australians remain free.
Thank you, Rose and Junichi. I'd now like to ask Samantha Walker from Canterbury Girls High School to announce the replays. Canterbury Nelson Park RSL sub-branch, Malcolm Little, OAM. Lynn Nichols and Tyler Fitzgerald. On behalf of Anthony Albanese, MP, member of the Australian Labor Party, Helen Rogers. On behalf of Canterbury Health and Park, RSL, Anyone else who is wishing to lay a wreath, you may now come and do so. For those who can, please stand for the last post, which will be followed by a minute's silence and a reveille. Isabella Katasi from Canterbury Girls High School will then recite the Ode of Remembrance. we shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them, lest we forget. Please remain standing for the national anthems of New Zealand and Australia. This will be followed by the dismount of the Catapults Party.
Thank you.
Please be seated. This marks the conclusion of this dawn service. We are grateful to have been given the opportunity to be involved in this dawn service, and we thank you for being here with us today.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, that concludes our service. On behalf of all of us, again, we warmly thank you for coming out on this morning. And remind you that it is warm and dry inside the club where we will be serving breakfast, and you can once again show your support for our veterans charities by attending breakfast. Please welcome me in thanking and congratulating the students from Canterbury Girls High School and Canterbury College School. And our performers, and in particular, we wish to thank the 23rd Field Battery of the 9th Regiment. They stepped in at the last minute. It was a mix-up, and they stepped in at the last minute, and we're very, very grateful for that. Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes the service. Please, you're welcome inside the club, and thank you once again.